Christ living undivided bride.
You need a strong east wind. You need a strong east wind to blow out your preconceived ideas. You need a strong east wind to blow out your religion. You need a strong east wind to blow out the doctrine of the scribes and Pharisees, which still possess your soul because you've not allowed the Holy Ghost to move in you and set you free.
A ministry with a vision. A ministry on the move. A ministry established by our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Think what God wants to do in his people is make his supernatural Holy Ghost fire and power clear to our sight, clear to our mind, so that there is no doubt in our spiritual creation who God is.
Bible for Christ Love International Ministry, a ministry with a vision built on a plan.
It is WW Word Wednesday. Who's ready for some Word Wednesday? All right, before we do anything else, we got to do it right. We got to pray. We got to get started in prayer. Amen. That's the best way to start. Dear Heavenly Father God, as we come before you, we humble ourselves, God, knowing that it's not about us, but it's about you. Holy Ghost, enter into this place today. Fill up every vessel with your anointing, with your spirit. Let the word of God come without compromise and without partiality, in power, spirit, and in truth. Father, right now we rebuke and bind any hindrance. We rebuke and bind any division. And God, we speak unity. Holy Ghost, unity, God. Take your liberty in this service, God. We dedicate it and give it to thy glory. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. All right, let's get ready. Let's praise the Lord, all right?
Get your hands up. Get your hearts up. Let's praise Jesus.
Yeah. Oh, who's excited to be in the house of God today? Oh, that was kind of pitiful. Let's hear some noise from RFC. Let's hear a shout of praise from God's people today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Today we're going to proclaim that you're going to win whatever situation you were going through. I promise we serve a miracle worker. We serve a victorious God. We serve a God who will bring you through. And I think that our God deserves a praise today. Woo!
You will win.
I need to know today if there's somebody out here that knows that we serve a great God. We serve a big God. And I came to tell you that you're going to win. Whatever the enemy's been fighting you with, you're going to get through. You're going to get through. Just proclaim. Say, you will win.
You will. Yes, you will.
say, I'm going to win. So great is that the man at the pool of Bethesda, he thought he couldn't win, but Jesus intervened. And I know there's some people that think you might not be able to win, but Jesus intervened, and he's telling somebody today, he's saying now, take up your bed and walk. Just take up your bed and walk. Take up your bed and walk. Take up your bed and walk. Say, take up your bed. Take up your bed and walk. Just take up your bed and walk. Take up your bed and walk. Take up your bed and walk. Walk to the King. Walk to the King. Take up your bed and walk. 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 Take up your bed and walk.
Take up your bed and walk.
Take up your bed and walk.
Take up your bed and walk.
Hey, you will win. Oh, I know that I'm gonna win in this season. I know that God is not a defeated God. He's much alive and well, and he's roaring right now. He's roaring right now. Oh, the lion of the tribe, he's roaring right now. He's roaring right now. He's roaring in this place. Hey.
You will.
Jesus! Let's all stand to our feet and just raise our hands to the Lord. Father, we love you. We glorify you. You deserve our praise tonight. Shout if you love Jesus! All right, we are so happy to be here in our Wednesday night Word Wednesday service. And it's great to see all of you here. I feel the presence of a mighty King. I know God's got something great for His people tonight. Tonight is my pleasure to introduce the junior flag team, the Winds of Fire.
Fixing my eyes on a new horizon. Joy before me, leave the past behind. There's no turning back, there's no turning back. Boldly I run into your presence, faith like a child, known and protected. Here in your arms, my shame is unraveling, unraveling. You made me underneath gray skies. Now I'm dancing in the light of heaven. Grace has found me, brought me back to life. There's no turning back, there's no turning back. Boldly I run into your presence, faith like a child.
Yeah.
Amen. Woo, that was beautiful. Thank you, ladies. All those ladies but one are daughters of the King in the mentorship program. And it's great to see them doing something wonderful for Jesus. All right, I'm going to ask everyone to stand up to your feet. Get those bodies moving because we're about to get crazy for Jesus. And I want you to turn to somebody and give them a great big Holy Ghost hug. Tell them God's got something for them tonight. All right. Amen. Okay, let's remain standing as we give honor to the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this evening. Yes, amen. All right, as you stand up to our feet tonight, it's my great honor and my privilege to introduce my best friend on the entire planet. And most of all, he is a servant of the great King Jesus. Tonight, let's give a round and a warm welcome to our chief apostle, Timothy Vanover, as he breaks the bread of life tonight. Hallelujah.
Ooh, praise the Lord. How many of you love the Lord tonight? Amen. Oh, come on. We can do a little better than that. How many of you love the Lord tonight? Amen. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice. Let's be glad in it. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm excited about the opportunity to come into the house of the Lord, to be able to praise my God, to worship the Lord. Amen. Let's go before the Lord in a word of prayer as we change the order of the service. Get into the word tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, God, as we come before you, God, we come not with our own ability nor by our own power, but God, we come by your Spirit, by your anointing, and by your authority. God, we give this service over to you completely, Lord, for you to do with as you choose. God, let your words and only your words be spoken here. Let your anointing and only your anointing be present here. God, we humble ourselves before you, knowing we are nothing and you are everything. In Jesus' mighty and powerful name we pray. Holy Ghost, you are welcome in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said, amen. Praise the Lord. You can be seated if you want to tonight as we get into this word tonight. I want to go back, if we could, please, real quick. I just want to read it one more time. Why don't you go with me, if you would please, to Galatians. Before we get into too much and start talking about the Holy Ghost flag of our country, I want to go back and just talk about Galatians again, just real quick, if I could, please. Now, on Sunday, like I said, I was talking about the fact that we are a royal priesthood and a holy nation, that God has got a different kind of nation, that we are a people passing through to a better country. The Bible says we wouldn't be saying that if we didn't mean it, if we weren't looking for another country. Now, maybe you want to stay here forever. I don't want to stay here forever. I just want to pass through this and get on to the next locale. Amen? Praise God. My next locale is with my Heavenly Father. And that's where I definitely want to be. Amen? Go to Galatians chapter 5 is where we were at, I believe. Galatians 5. Galatians 5. And we're going to go back to the first verse of Galatians 5. I am reading out of the Amplified Classic. So this is Galatians 5 and 1. In this freedom, Christ hath made us free, and completely liberated us. Stand fast then, and be ye not hampered and held ensnared, and submit again to the yoke of slavery which you have once put off. One thing you need to understand is the goal for the devil is to try to get you back, to try to get you entangled. That's his number one goal. He knows that if he's found a weakness in you before and he can control you with that weakness and he can move you around with that weakness, he wants to use that weakness against you again and again. So he'll do everything he can to try to get you entangled to that temptation. But you need to understand something. The Bible says, he who God has set free is free indeed. He that is free indeed. The free indeed part is when you begin to put the image and the nature of Jesus Christ in your heart and your life, and you begin to let that image rise up, then you're not just free, you're free indeed. Because when the temptation comes, when the enemy comes, when the demons come, and they begin to see that image and that nature of Jesus Christ rising up out of you, and the words that you speak are not your words, and the actions and the steps that you take are not your steps, but they're his steps. Then the devil starts getting concerned. Because now he's not just dealing with the temptation of your flesh. You have altered it. You have altered the temptation of your flesh by putting in a Holy Ghost buffer that removes the control of the temptation. You understand what I'm saying? Once you get that Holy Ghost buffer in there, it can remove the control of that. You say, Brother Vanover, that's not Bible. Oh, yes, it is. The Bible says the same spirit that raised, this is Romans 8, the same spirit that raised up Jesus Christ from the dead, if it dwells in you, Daryl, it has the ability to cause you to abstain from being subjected to sin. That when sin rises, that image and nature of Christ will rise above it, and it will say no to that desire, no to that addiction. Now see, the reason that you get defeated and the reason you fall back into the addiction is because you did not apply the indeed part. See, you walked as free, but you did not imply, you did not apply indeed. See, he who's been set free is set free what? Indeed. The indeed part is when you take you, bring you under subjection, and let Jesus rise up in you. Let the Holy Ghost rise up in you. Honey, see, can I explain something? I'm going to make y'all mad. Y'all get glad again. Can I explain something to you? This is going to liberate you for the rest of your life. Do you know why the devil's addictions can't get you when you're in need? Why can't the devil's addictions get you, Aletheia, when you have activated in need? When you've because you know why? Can I lay this way? Jesus ain't an alcoholic. Jesus is not a drug addict. Jesus is not a luster for porno. Yeah, nah, you get a hold of what I'm telling you. When you activate indeed, you're activating Jesus Christ. When you activate Jesus Christ and the devil tries to come and use the temptation of alcohol, that image of Christ rises up and says, but I am not an alcoholic. Come on, but I'm going to get you with drugs. Yeah, but I ain't a drug addict. Yes, you are. Oh, no, no, no. Timothy might have been, but now Timothy has been trumped by the Holy Ghost. Timothy has been trumped by the image of Christ. Now, you said, Brother Brown, it's not Bible. Then Romans 8's a liar. Because Romans 8 said, if the same spirit that dwells in you that raised up Jesus Christ from the dead, it gives you the ability to mortify the deeds of your body. Mortify is a smaller word of the word mortification. That word mortification means the ability to abstain from. So he gives you the ability to say no. He gives you the ability to abstain from. But the problem is, when the temptation comes, we might be standing in what we think is true, but we have not activated indeed. Come on, we might be standing on what we think's true, but we've not enacted indeed. So then, when the devil tries to torment us or tries to tempt us, our flesh reacts to it. Our flesh responds to it because he's trying to pull that flesh. He's trying to tempt that flesh. But all of a sudden, when you start feeling yourself slip, start feeling yourself slip down in there, start feeling yourself slip away, all of a sudden you go, wait a minute, I need to activate indeed. He whom God has set free is free indeed. So right now, in the name of Jesus, I bring this flesh under subjection. Let this mind be in me, which was also in Christ Jesus. Father, raise up the anointing. Raise up the Holy Ghost. Raise up the Spirit. Raise up the power of God. And show me what addiction takes you now. Show me what addiction. Simply put, Mike, when you are full of the image of Christ, when you are full of his nature, when you're walking with the fullness of the Holy Ghost and the mind of Christ, how can the devil tempt someone who is not addicted? How can the devil tempt you with alcohol
When you're so full of Christ, all anybody sees is Jesus. And guess what? Jesus is non-alcoholic. So he's not tempted by alcohol.
Come on now.
He's not tempted by drugs.
Come on.
He's not tempted by fame.
Come on.
He's not tempted by wealth.
Amen.
Uh-oh. Now I'm, oh, God, I'm going to get us off.
Go ahead, Tom. Go ahead, Chief.
You're going to have to sneak me out of here, D. You know what else that means, don't you?
Go ahead.
If all you want, oh, Lord, if all you want is wealth, if all you want is fame, if all you want is all these other things, guess what is not in you? Jesus. Because he doesn't want those things. So the minute you stand up and start talking about how much you want all the things of the world, and you want a new car, you want to, you've already identified to me that you have not activated Indeed. Indeed is not activated. Oh, y'all ain't hearing me. Indeed is not activated in you. Indeed is not in you. Because if you enacted it, you know the truth, but you know the truth indeed shall set you free. If you know that Christ Jesus will give you liberty, Christ Jesus will give you victory, why do you not apply his image and his nature in your daily life? Because we still want to do some of those things. We want to have an out so that we can have a little sin vacation when it rolls around. But see, you need to understand something. The only thing that's going to truly liberate you from the bondage of the flesh, from the desires of the flesh, is when you press that flesh so far down that the oil of the anointing has drowned you and consumed you, and the image and nature of Christ is active in you. See, when you activate, see, you know how come I can tell you with honesty, hand on the Bible, and mean it, I don't want the things of this world, I don't want this stuff, is because I've activated Indeed. And see, Jesus in me ain't interested in that stuff. Did y'all know that? I'm going to make y'all mad. Y'all like, I'm going to tell you something. Oh, my Lord, this will rock the entire Christian world. This will rock them about what I'm about to tell you, but it's true. Get a hold of this. God does not want you to be a millionaire. He does not want you to have everything your heart desires. He does not want you to have everything your flesh desires. What he wants you to do is to have a relationship with him. What he wants you to do is hunger for him. What he wants you to do is get into a place where the image and the nature of Jesus Christ is more than just words on a page, more than just what somebody told you, but it's living and resonating in your life. It's coming alive in you, making you the vessel God intended for you to be. Making you a vessel meet for the master's use. Amen. Okay, anyway, I got to keep going. Let's go here. Now he said, and this freedom Christ hath made us free and completely what? What is the next part of that? And completely did something. Completely liberated us. Completely liberated us. In the King James, it says, stand fast therewith with the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free and not entangled again to the what? Okay, wait a minute. Did I or did I not just tell you a minute ago that if you activated Indeed, if you activated Jesus Christ, the temptation of alcohol and drugs would not affect you, right? Isn't that what he just said? You will not be entangled what? Again. Isn't that what it just said? You won't be entangled again. So if you're getting entangled again, you're not activating Indeed. That's your problem. If you're getting entangled again, you're trying to deal with it in your own flesh. And that's why you're failing. But if you'll activate Christ, if you'll activate that image and nature of Christ, the Word of God gives you a promise. It tells you, stand therefore in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made you free, and let and be not entangled again into the yoke of bondage. You're not supposed to go back to it again. He said he's liberated us. Stand fast therefore and be not hampered and held ensnared, and submit again to the yoke of slavery which you once have put off. Question for anyone that's ever been in this room addicted to anything. Is that or is that not probably the most accurate explanation of addiction? Slavery. Who would agree with that? Slavery. You're driven by the drugs. You're driven by the alcohol. You're driven by whatever it is you have submitted yourself to. So why do you want to continue to be enslaved to that? Why do you not want to be free from it?
Why do you not want to activate Christ and get totally free from it? And say, listen, man, I want to have Christ so much in me that I don't even think about that stuff anymore. I want to have Christ so much in me that I don't even desire it anymore. I want to have Christ so much in me that the devil's scared to come and try to tempt me with it. Because he knows if he starts tempting me with it, I'll start praying and I'll go get 10 more delivered and set free. He better leave me alone. Coming up here trying to tempt me. I'll start praying, getting in, speaking in tongues, let the Holy Ghost flow in me. You'll get, see, give the devil what he don't want. That is a Holy Ghost fired up Jesus reflector. He don't want that. Give him everything he don't want. Notice it is I, Paul, who tells you that if you receive circumcision, Christ will be of no profit to you or advantage to you, any avail. He goes to you, and if you distrust him, you can gain nothing from him. So he's trying to explain something to you here about the process. He's trying to tell him with the circumcision stuff. Said, listen, man, religion is not going to do it for you. It's not about being religious. Not about the religious ceremonies. Not about all those kind of things. He said, listen, there are some of you here. He said, man, you got that religion going on. Ain't done nothing for you. Ain't changed. Ain't brought you nowhere to God. Ain't brought you no closer to the Lord at all. And look what he said. He said, it's no profit. It's no advantage or avail to you. He said, what advantages you, what avails you is, do you have faith? Do you believe in Christ? Do you believe in God's word? He said, if you can't believe it without a ceremony, then it's not faith. If you can't believe it without a ceremony, then it's something your eyes have to see. But see, faith is what? The substance of what? Faith is what? And the evidence what? What is the evidence? What is the evidence? Well, if you're doing ceremonies, you're not activating by evidence that's not seen. You're acting by evidence you can see. Amen? See, God wants you to operate in faith. God wants you to move and work in faith. Now, look what he said. I want, and I like what he says here. He says, for if you distrust him, you will gain nothing from him. If you don't operate in faith, you'll never get nothing from God. I once more protest and testify to every man who receives circumcision that he is under the obligation and bound to practice the whole of the law and its ordinances. He said, if you want to put your righteousness, you want to put your faith, you want to put your relationship with God, you want to put it on the legalism, you want to put on ceremonialism, you want to put on religion, that's fine. He said, you can do that if you want to, but if you're going to do it, you have to follow the whole law. You have to follow all of it. You have to do all the washings. You have to do all the other things. You have to follow 650 laws to do that. If you want to do it, you can, but you got to do it that way. And at the end of it, it still won't work. If you followed all the laws to perfection, it would still fail in the fact that you are flesh. And you need a Savior. And the only way you get out of it is the extinguishing of the flesh. And what is the extinguishing of the flesh? The extinguishing of the flesh can only take place by the one that has defeated the flesh. And we are not the one that defeated it. We succumbed to it. We gave up and succumbed to it. But there was one 2,000 years ago when he was tempted in all ways as man is tempted. But guess what? He did not succumb to this flesh. He did not yield to this flesh. He did not fall to the desires of this flesh. But our Bible tells us he rose above it. Even though he was in the flesh, he was not a debtor to the flesh to live after the flesh. But he walked by the power. He walked by the Spirit. He walked by the anointing of a living God. There was no hypocrisy. There was no partiality. There was no compromise in him. And because of that, we now have that ability in his name to do the same thing. But it has to be in his name. Let's go on with what it says. It goes on and says, if you seek to be justified and declared righteous and to be given a right standing with God through the law, you are brought to nothing. And so separated and severed from Christ, you have fallen away from grace, from God's gracious favor, and unmerited blessing. You know, I always love it when people want to get up and they want to preach to you about grace and mercy. And they want to tell you about God's grace and God's mercy and how graceful and merciful he is. And it doesn't make any difference what you do. He's going to be graceful and merciful. And he's going to show you grace and mercy. And you just keep on sinning for all eternity, and there is grace and mercy. That is not the grace and the mercy of the Lord. Here is the grace and the mercy of the Lord. This is it, extension of it, all there is. His grace is that while you did not deserve an inheritance. While you did not deserve to be set free, while you did not deserve to be filled with the anointing of the Spirit of God, while you did not deserve to be joint heirs with Christ Jesus, he gave you a way to become a joint heir with Christ Jesus. That was gracious. Graceful. Nothing we could do, nothing we could make happen, couldn't make it happen. The grace was that he gave you an ability to become a son and daughter when you didn't deserve it. Okay? The mercy was realizing and acknowledging you could not do it on your own. You couldn't accomplish it by yourself. You could not get there in yourself. You could not come into right standing with God in your own ability by your carnal mind or your natural ability. But it required a supernatural force. It required a supernatural reaction to take place. That supernatural reaction came through the Word and the Spirit of God. As the Word and the Spirit of God came together, they released an anointing of revelation. In the knowledge of that revelation came the understanding of transformation. From that transformation that takes place, we now have manifestation. The ability to manifest his image, the ability to manifest his nature, the ability to manifest who he is. Amen? Praise the Lord. Somebody say amen with me. Okay. But I want you to look now. I want you to listen to me. Here's the thing. You can't do it in yourself. The mercy is that he gave you a way to do it. Because he knew your flesh was incapable. He knew there was no shot for you. There was no hope for you. But he said, if they will accept Jesus Christ, I can cleanse them with the blood of Jesus, and then I can fill them with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And he said, if I can get those two elements placed in the tabernacle, if I can get the Word and the Spirit of God placed in the tabernacle, those are the two holy elements, the Holy Bible, the Word of God, and the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit of God. If I can get those two elements into the tabernacle working together in unison, guess what? I will release the image and nature of Jesus Christ. As I release the image and nature of Jesus Christ, they will now have an ability to abstain from sin, to say no to their carnality and yes to their spiritual man that they did not previously have. So when you want to talk about grace and mercy, there it is. Gracefulness, that he gave you an inheritance you did not deserve. Mercy, that he provided his son to give you the ability to overcome when he understood you could not do it on your own. Can you say praise God? Honey, that in itself is amazing. So understand, grace and mercy are not excuses for you to go and sin. And they're not excuses for you to go out. What it actually needs to be is there needs to be a spiritual preparation, a spiritual recognition, a spiritual understanding and acknowledgement that, you know what? It is time that I bring this flesh under subjection. It is time that I stop playing church and I start becoming the church. It is time that I stop talking about who Christ is and start letting him come alive in me, letting him start living in me. Too often I've been in control. It's time for me to get out of control and get him in control. Let me ask you a question. How many times have you got out of the way and let God make the decisions? And how many times has it just been you and your flesh? How many times was it you when something got challenged about you that maybe wasn't something you liked, you got angry? You got angry because it got brought out. Question is, was it the truth? Then why are you angry? Oh, you got embarrassed because it got brought out. It embarrassed you because it brought out. Well, you know what? If you didn't want that to happen, you shouldn't have done it. See, that's the thing. If you didn't do nothing, you got nothing to talk about. But if you do, and it comes out, you don't have to be embarrassed over things your flesh did. Just acknowledge that they were done by your flesh, and they don't need to be done again. That's how you work that problem out. No, that was my flesh, man. That was wrong. I'm going to do that no more. But see, too often, we allow our flesh to defend our flesh. We allow our flesh to defend our flesh. And you know what? We got to stop doing that. We got to start letting the Holy Ghost scrutinize and scourge the flesh if necessary. Oh, y'all don't want to hear that, see? I know, man. I get it, man. I know I'm not popular. I'm not going to preach to you about how wealthy you're going to be, how rich you're going to be, about the new wife, the new car, the new job you're going to get. That's not what you're going to get from me. You're going to get the truth from me. You're going to get that we are living in a place where God wants you to rise above the lusts, the desires, and the wants of this world. He wants you to be filled with his anointing. He wants you to be filled with his word. He wants you to be filled with his spirit. He wants to rise you up, set your feet on a solid foundation, and begin to pour out an anointing on you like you've never had before. An anointing that will raise you to the highest level of relationship with God that you have ever known, that you have ever had. But you got to get there, amen? You got to get there. And that starts with you acknowledging and realizing how much time in your life is occupied by the manifestation of Jesus Christ. And how much of your time is occupied in you manifesting you. How much? How much?
How much?
How much time do you spend showing Jesus Christ? How much time do you spend letting Him live in your life? How much time do you let Him reflect out of your actions and speech? How often, when someone offends you, you immediately respond in your flesh to defend yourself, as opposed to stopping and waiting and saying, Lord, do you want me to say anything or should I walk on? Lord, should I keep my mouth shut? How many times have you done that? Somebody gave you a piece of their mind, but before you answered, you took some time to pray and seek God first. Or did you just answer? Come on. Sometimes we don't filter it like we need to. Sometimes we don't filter it like we should. Let's go on. Go look what he says. Fourth verse. If you seek to justify and be declared righteous and be given right standing from God through the law, you are brought to nothing and so separated and severed from Christ. You have fallen away from grace and God's gracious favor and unmerited blessing. See, he said you fell away from His grace. Why? You fell away from the thing He gave you grace for, Jesus Christ. He gave you grace to come out of that situation with Jesus Christ. You spit that and put it back in His face. I don't need that. Let's go on. For we, not relying on the law, but through the what? Through the Holy Ghost, help. Wait a minute. What do you, hold on a second. Wait a second. Hold on just a second. What did he say? He said, I got to read that again. For we, not relying on the what? Not relying on the what? Not relying on the what? That means not relying on legalism, ceremonialism, ritualism, none of those things, not relying on any of that, not relying on an outward ceremony to express an inward faith. Not relying on that. But look what he said. We don't rely on that. He said, but through the Holy Ghost's help. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. Y'all ain't listening to me. How do we establish faith? How do we establish our relationship with Jesus Christ? Through the help of the Holy Ghost. Now my question, Brother Darrell, is how do you get help from someone you do not know? I'm just asking a question. That's a Bible. How do you get help from the Holy Ghost who you don't know? You're just like those guys in Acts 19. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? We don't even so much know if there be a Holy Ghost or not. Then what baptism have you been baptized with? You know, we will kill ourselves. Nothing wrong with it. We will kill ourselves to make sure every single person gets baptized in water. But we will not do the same to get them baptized with the Holy Ghost. That's fine, baby, but let's start trying to get them filled with the Holy Ghost, too. Honey, you may want to dunk them. That's fine. Dunk them and chunk them. But, honey, let me tell you something. It's time to get them filled with the Holy Ghost. It's time to get them filled with the Spirit of God. It's time to give them that very element, that very thing that can provide help, that very thing that can bring the revelation and the knowledge of the Word of God alive, that very thing that can assemble together the spiritual knowledge and the spiritual understanding to establish an everlasting Holy Ghost kingdom. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise Lord. Hey, I didn't write it. I'm just reading it to you. I love what that says, man. Through the what? Through the help. Woo, somebody, that'll make somebody shout right there. He said, by faith, we anticipate and wait for the blessing and good for which our righteousness and right standing with God are conformity. Now see, here's the part that people haven't figured out. That's why you hear virtue, nurture, and nincompoops that say stupid stuff. like you can't increase righteousness any longer, which is about the dumbest statement any idiot could ever make. Because let me explain something to you. You cannot maintain a right standing with someone if you do not maintain a relationship with them. You have to maintain a relationship. As you maintain that relationship with Christ, you get in right standing. The more you conform, here is the key. This is the answer to it. He gives it to you right in the Amplified. Look what he says. Right in the Amplified, he gives it to you. He goes, good righteousness and right standing with God are, and how do we do that? How do we stay in right standing with our God? Our conformity to his will in purpose, thought, and action. There it is right there. If you want to get in right standing with God, you conform to his will, to his purpose, to his thought, to his speech, to what he says. In your life, you must conform. If you want to be in right standing with God, you've got to say, what is God's will? What is God's purpose? What is God's word concerning me? I will obey that will. I will obey that purpose. I will speak that word. And when I'm stepping forward, when I'm walking in my life, when I'm carrying out my daily activities, I will activate indeed. Amen. I will activate indeed. And that image of Christ will keep me out of trouble. Can you say amen? You think about it, man. Think about it, guys. How much sinning do you do openly in front of Jesus Christ? Now think about if you've got him living in you and reflecting out of you, how much better it will be for you to stay away from some of those sins. Amen? Right? Come on, think about it. Kind of hard for the devil to motivate you when Christ is taking up residence, when Christ has control, right? Amen? Come on, let's go. I got to hurry. I don't think I'm going to get into what y'all wanted me to get into today. I'm afraid just didn't get enough time for that. So. Yeah. I'll come back Sunday and preach on the phone. Because I don't think I'm going to, the Lord changed it on me. I don't think I'm going to make it to the flag. So let's go on. Let's go on. Oh, Lord. Yeah, this is the Lord. This is all God. He changed it up. He does that sometimes. Let's go on. He goes on and says, for if we are in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for what? Now, what he is basically telling you spiritually is it don't matter if you're religious or non-religious. It don't matter. No religious action, no religious ceremony, no religious ritual will bring you one step closer to Jesus Christ. Will not do it. Will not do it. The only way you're going to get there is when you bring your flesh under subjection and you press it down so the oil of the anointing rises. And as the oil of the anointing rises, as you begin to yield to the Word, to the Spirit, to the anointing, to the power of God, as that image and nature of Christ begins to rise in you, then you have the power to say no to sin. You say no to it. Because that image and nature of Christ is in you. Amen. And he's telling you, it don't make no difference. He said, you can be as religious as you want. You can be as non-religious as you want to. It has absolutely no bearing on any of it at all. The bearing is in the relationship. Amen. Let's go on. I got to hurry. Let's go on. He goes on and says, okay, here he goes. He goes, okay, let's see. Counts for anything, but only, oh man, I love this, only faith activated, energized, and expressed, and working through love. He said the only way it's going to work, he says, is when you get faith that has been activated, has been energized, and expressed, and working through love. Can I give an example of that? Peter looked at Jesus and said, Lord, bid me come and I will come. And Jesus said, come. Peter did not step out of the boat to be seen. He did not step out of the boat thinking he was going to walk on water. He did not step out of the boat for any of those reasons. He stepped out of that boat because of love. Because he loved God. Because he loved Jesus. He stepped out strictly because of love. And haven't you figured it out yet? Without love, you cannot activate faith. It takes love. The reason that his faith was activated and that he walked on the water and was able to walk when the storm was coming on the water was because he moved by love. His faith was initiated by love. His faith was initiated by love. Everything Jesus did, when faith was initiated, it was because I love my Father that I do these things. I love this. I love. It's always love. Always done in love. Always done in love. Everything I've ever done in my life, every time my faith has ever been activated, it came from love. It came from prayer because I love my Father so much. I love God so much. I want to obey Him. I want to be obedient to Him. Lord, what I got to do? So the minute that I get consumed by that love, my faith increases and gives me the ability to react. Amen? Praise God. How many understand what I'm saying? Amen? Okay, let's go on. I got to hurry. He goes on and says, he goes, you were running the race nobly. Who has interfered in and hindered and stopped you from your heeding and following the truth? This evil persuasion is not of him who hath called you, who invited you to freedom in Christ Jesus. So he's saying, who's come along and tried to steal your victory? Who's come along and tried to damper your love? Who's come along and tried to remove the indeed? Who came along and tried to take these things out? And look what he says here. He gives you the answer to it. Here's what he says. Look what he says. He goes on and says, a little leaventh. It don't take much. It just takes a little tiny bit. And it says a little leaventh, a slight inclination to error or a few false teachers, leavens the whole lump. It perverts the whole conception of faith. Are you looking at that? It ruins the whole conception of faith. He said what happens is when you bring a little flesh in, when you bring just a little flesh, when you make excuse for a little flesh, he said you have now contaminated the whole lump. Now there can be no truth. Now there can be no freshness. Now there can be no faith flow from it. He said that's why you got to purge out the leaven. Purge it all out till there's not any left. Honey, we've got to press. We've got to purge. We've got to beat. We've got to shake till it's completely out. Till there's nothing left but that image. There's nothing left but that nature. There's nothing left but the Word, the Spirit, the anointing, and the power of God. Don't you understand? God is looking for a manifestation of Jesus Christ in the hearts of the men and women of God. God is looking for a manifestation of Christ as the world has never seen. As the world has never seen. It will be the greatest manifestation of Christ that the world has ever seen. Now look what he says. For my part, I have confidence towards you in the Lord that you will take no contrary view of the matter, but will come to think with me. But he who is unsettling you, whoever he is, will have to bear the penalty. Honey, there are those that come in to steal, kill, and destroy. There's those that come in to try to take and try to steal from you. But this is the day. This is the hour. This is the moment when you can rise to a place of spiritual excellency that you've never stood in before. This is an opportunity for you to move in to a greater dimension of faith than you have ever known before, operating by a fruitful, anointed intelligence that is not based on your carnal mind or your natural mind, but operating by a new principle, a new understanding, the ability to see the Word of God, not with physicality, but with spiritual knowledge and spiritual understanding. To be able to glean from that Word and that Spirit the ability to indeed activate indeed so that the image and nature of Christ may be in you. Amen. Praise the Lord. God has given us a different nation, a different country. Our country is not a country of religion. Our country is not a country of legalism. Our country is not a country of religiosity. Our country is not a country of trying to play church. We're not just occupying an acre of land. What I'm telling you we're doing right now is we're going to be a city upon a hill that cannot be hid. We're going to be a people with salt, and our salt has not lost its savior. There is a spiritual, anointed, living truth that is in God's people, and it is going to rise up as it has never risen before. You're going to be the nation that God has called you to be. And as every country, as every nation has a flag that they raise high to identify what country they are, to identify who they are, your country has a flag too. But your country's flag is not on a flagpole. Your country's flag is in the heart of the citizen. It's in the heart of every citizen. Amen. And maybe Sunday I can tell you how it flies in the wind. How it goes in the wind. Your little Holy Ghost. Amen. Praise God. We need to understand something. Whoever it is that comes in this place to unsettle us, we need to take note of that. Because God has given us good, fresh bread. Something to be happy about. We love each and every one of you. We want you to be everything God called you to be. Step into the fullness of your calling. Be what God's called you to be. Amen. Step into the fullness of who He is and what He is. Amen. Go with me, if you would, please. I'm going to close out here. Go with Galatians real quick. Galatians 3:1. Oh, you poor and silly and thoughtless and unreflecting. Oh, yes, I have read it before. And senseless Galatians. That is what you would say to flesh right there. You poor and silly and thoughtless and unreflecting and senseless Galatians, who hath fascinated or bewitched or cast a spell over you, unto whom right before your very eyes Jesus Christ the Messiah was openly and graphically set forth and portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you this one question. Did you receive the Holy Ghost as a result of obeying the law and doing its works, or was it by hearing the message of the gospel and believing on it? Was it from the observation of the law of rituals or from the message of faith? This is all you need to ask any church when you walk into it. Do you get your message by rituals and ceremonies? Or do you get your relationship by faith? Because if it ain't by faith, I don't want no part of it. I don't want to be a part of religion. I don't want to be a part of religiosity. Honey, Paul's looking at him. He said, who bewitched you? Who put a spell on you? Who came and confused you? This is not how you get a relationship with God. He said, did you get the Holy Ghost through religious ceremonies, through religion, or did you get it by the hearing of faith? What'd you get it by? And I say the same thing to you today. If we don't get the spiritual things of God through ritualism, through ceremonies, through legalism, then what is our justification to continue to support them and continue to do them in our services? Just to make us feel holy and righteous. I would rather seek something spiritual, something deeper, something more intimate, something that goes into the heart of man and the soul of man, something that's deep in here that brings you into full relationship with God. I don't know about you, but I didn't come to church to play church. I came to church to be the church. Amen. And if I'm going to be the church, and I'm going to tell you something right now, if the Bible tells me my God is a spirit and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. John 6:63 tells me very clearly, it is the spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. If these are the things that God is telling me, if these are the things that God is giving me, why am I looking to embrace anything else? Why am I allowing anything else? I will tell you now, there needs to be a purification of the true churches of God. There needs to be a purification of the Holy Ghost anointed church of God, that we say no longer will we worship him in ceremony, no longer will we worship him in religious or religiosity, but we will worship him in a humbleness, in a repentance, in our face before God, saying, God, not my will, but your will be done. God, forgive me for every element that I've ever done that did not glorify your son, Jesus Christ. We need to be on our faces repenting. We need to be humble. And we need to realize that this is about the spirit and not your flesh. Amen. He told them, what makes you think that you've begun now in the spirit that you will finish in the flesh? That's what I say to churches around the world today. What makes you think you got filled with the Holy Ghost? The anointing and the Spirit of God came in and saved and delivered and set people free. And now you think we go back to the flesh? We try to do it physically. We try to let the world tell us how to have church. We try to have church where everybody's comfortable. Honey, let me tell you something. It's not about comfortability. It's about truth. It's not about you being comfortable or me being comfortable. It's about truth. That Bible, I have to live by it. You have to live by it. We all have to live by it. Nobody gets an exclusion. Nobody gets out. We all have to walk by the anointing. We all have to walk by the Spirit. We all have to walk by the Word of God. What flag is in your heart? Is it your flag? Is it the flag of the world? Or is it his flag? What flag is in your land right now? If you shall know the truth, it shall set you free indeed. But there are some of you need to learn how to activate the indeed. You want to walk in freedom, but you don't want to reflect the image of your freedom. And the image of your freedom is Jesus Christ. Amen. See, you got a choice to make. You can be stubborn. You can be hard-headed. And you can go right out there in the world and live like the rest of the world and think that it would be different for you. But I just want to tell you something that you need to get a hold of real quick. Look around you. Look around this room. Look around you. There are some people here that are probably not as handsome as you or not as good looking as you or not as suave and sophisticated as you. But you know what? You're also going to find some people that are prettier than you, that are more sophisticated than you, that are sharper than you. And the world did not love them. What makes you think it will love you? What makes you think it's going to love you? You're not somebody special. They came up with special looks and special this and special that. The world wants one thing, to use you and destroy you as quickly and as fast as possible. And when they're done, they'll be done with you. See, one thing you need to realize, you got a group of people that love you, a group of people that are here, a group of people that have loved you, from many of you, from the day you were born. There is no advantage for them to look past your faults and love you anyway. There's no advantage to them except it's what our master commands. It's what our master demands. Let me tell you something. The one thing I can tell you, I've watched hundreds come through those doors that the world treated them terrible, eat them up and spit them out and did not treat them good. But you know what? I have yet to see one person walk through that door that could tell me something that would ever convince me to abandon what I have embraced. Never seen that person yet. Never seen that person yet. And I was a very successful person in the world. I made very, very good money in the world. Back in 19, just to give you kind of a viewpoint of how blessed that the Lord had made me, back in 1980-something, I made $67,000 a year. And I lived at home with my parents. My bills were zero. I was 20-some years old making $60,000 a year. Listen, being successful in the world, as long as you work hard and you're willing to bend a few rules, you can get a lot of things done. Amen? But I will tell you something. I've worked for the Lord a whole lot longer and not made nearly as much. I remember my first big revival went all the way to Bartlesville, Oklahoma. Me and Pastor Chris went all the way to Bartlesville. Barely had enough money for gas. Got down to Bartlesville, Oklahoma. They gave us the offering. Of course, we were respectful. Not going to count the offering till you leave the church. We left the church, counted our offering. We had enough money for a tank of gas back home. And we split a quarter pounder with cheese from McDonald's. That's all we could afford. But you know what? I had more joy and more happiness splitting that little old cheeseburger with Chris than taking all that money and sticking it in my bank account. Let me tell you why. Because you know what? That money that I was sticking in that bank account, that was for me. That was all about me. But you know what? I just delivered my heart. Just delivered my soul. I just saw people's life change. I saw them rearranged. It no longer mattered. The money was not the issue any longer. All that mattered is somebody's life could get changed forever. Somebody's life could get changed for all eternity. That person, their whole life could get changed. I have people in my life who their whole lives got changed by the gospel. You know, I was talking about Pastor Chris, one of my best friends. Pastor Chris, easily, he'll be the first one to tell you, had God not delivered him and set him free and filled him with the Holy Ghost, he would have stuck a gun in his head and pulled the trigger. He would have told you that himself. You wouldn't even recognize Pastor Chris if you'd have met him back in the day. Hair down to here. He took more hits of acid than anybody I've ever known in my life and still survived, you know. But the day he found Jesus Christ, it changed his life forever. And you know what? I have been able to feed into that life for 40-plus years. And because I was able to feed into that life, it was able to touch the life of Alethea and the life of Ryan and the life of Tasha and the life of Priscilla and Andrew and Orion and Apollo. And where will it end? Right on down the line. All because of an act of obedience. Not motivated by religion. Not motivated by agenda, but motivated by love and by relationship. Simply because I love God so much, I want to show His image to you. Because I know in His image, there is hope. Yes, amen, hope. Praise the Lord. Don't you love the Lord tonight? He's worthy to be praised. Well, I ended up just doing a little testifying tonight. So I testified a little bit. But I think there's some people out there that might be ready to activate some Indeed. I think you want to activate a little Indeed, right? Come here, JJ. Praise the Lord. Zoe, come on over here. Praise God. Just lift up your hands and begin to worship the Lord. Right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus. There it is. Yep. Release. There it is. A fresh, a new, a deeper. God said 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 indeed, 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 indeed. There it is. Just grab it all. Grab it all. Grab it all. Grab it all. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Just begin to lift up the Lord. He's worthy to be praised. That's it. Just go ahead. Let it begin to happen. The Father said He's going to begin to take you into a deeper place. See, right now, He's lifted up His hand to your mouth. Gave you just a little drink. Just give you a little drink of that fresh, sweet, anointed water. But now He's reaching both hands down into the He's going to cup it and bring up a bigger drink. A bigger drink. How much you want depends on how close you want to get. The closer you get, the more you get. But you have to. But it will change you. You'll never be the same. It'll change you. You have to say you want that. You have to want it. You got to want it. If you don't want it, He won't give it to you. You got to want it. See, that's the thing. People got to be careful what they ask God. Don't ask Him something you don't really want. You got to really want something. Come here, Jeff. Praise God. I want you to lift up your hands and begin to worship the Lord, Jeff. Like never before, God. Never before. The Lord said, son, I want to bring you further than you've ever come before. But it's got to be something you want. You got to hunger for it. You got to thirst for it. You got to reject everything that brings division, everything that causes you to look in every other direction. You've got to purge out every negative element that has held you down. I have a plan for you, and I have a purpose for you. You gotta want it. You gotta want it with all your heart. I don't give people what they don't want. If you want it, I can give it to you. But you just gotta want it. Just gotta want it. Praise the Lord. Come on, somebody lift up Jesus. He's worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Brother Tommy, would you come here, brother? Brother Tommy, come here, Tommy. Just trying to pray with you, brother. Praise God. I want you to just worship the Lord. The enemy would like to come and cause all kinds of turmoil, and the enemy would like to come and cause confusion. Enemy would like to come and cause problems. But God said, son, I love you. And I'm going to begin to touch you in a new way. I'm going to begin to bring an understanding you've never had before. In Jesus. Fresh. All the confusion, go. Everything, go, God. Peace, I speak. Father, stir that gift up. Stir that peace up. Son, I'm going to begin to bring you into a new day. A new day, saith the Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. In Jesus' name. Let's just lift up the Lord. He's worthy to be praised tonight. In Jesus' name. God, I give you full praise, full honor, full glory, God. There ain't nobody like Jesus. Nobody means more than Jesus. Amen. He's everything. You want to start seeing yourself be stronger against the temptations of the enemy and against the elements he brings to you. Start activating the indeed. If you activate Christ, the indeed, you'll find out how you can say no to things. Amen? Praise the Lord. You love Jesus today?
Hello and thank you so much. However you got here, we're glad you made it to the Flame Christian Network. I'm Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover. I'm the founder of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries right here in Moore, Oklahoma. The Flame Network is a new extension of our ministry. It's an extension to give opportunity to those that are filled with the Spirit and the power of God. We want a network that will show the flame, the fire, the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And that's why this network was created. Now keep watching because we're going to be changing things as the years and months continue. As a matter of fact, we'll be adding some Christian sitcoms, also some different activities, even some different programming from some of our friends that love the flame of the Holy Ghost. If you want a network that believes in the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost, you found it with the flame. Stay tuned. We've got more great things coming your way.
Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm International Evangelist and Administrative Vice President of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send in your checks or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.